UNESCO, which is, as you know, the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, that invited Dr. Kama to head this project. Through the planning, efforts and leadership of Sharnaz Kama and her core committee, this project attracted worldwide interest and recognition, which in turn led in August 2002 to the establishment of the Parzo Foundation as a registered society. Parzo being the acronym for Parsi Zoroastrian, the full name of the registered society being Parzo Foundation for the Preservation of Vulnerable Human Heritage. General Adi Setna was the first president of the foundation, and I knew him well. He was a great and joyous Zoroastrian. It was he who first told me that the Parsi Zoroastrians in India, as well as the Parsi Zoroastrians now living in various parts of the Western world, had been reared in a tradition and culture entirely different from that of the very large number of Zoroastrians living in Central Asia. And yet, it was the latter who were keen to scrupulously observe the tenets of our religion. That is why, Dr. Setna told me, it was that the Zoroastrians of Tajikistan and not the Parsi Zoroastrians of India that first approached UNESCO to initiate a celebration on a global basis for the birth anniversary of the Prophet Zarathustra. Under the leadership of Dr. Sharnaz Kama, the Parzo Foundation has done remarkably good work.
On behalf of Mazda Multimedia, a warm welcome to all for this season one, our very own episode number 8. Today we are going to present to you the story of a daughter, a sister, a teacher, an educationist who's been working very quietly in the field for more than 4 decades for the benefit of the Parsi community and towards preserving the Parsi culture. I have with me today Dr. Sharnaz Kama. Dr. Kama is an associate professor for English and Classics at the Lady Sriram College, University of Delhi. She's also the director of UNESCO PASOR and the advisor for Fulbright Educational Program, USIEF, the national director for the popular GeoParsi program under the Ministry of Minority Affairs, Government of India, besides holding many other positions. And Dr. Kama is always very busy, running from one commitment to another. So before she runs away from this one, let me jump straight away to the questions. Dr. Kama, we Parsis are a very small community, numbering 57,264 as per the 2011 census, of which Maharashtra has both the maximum population, 44,854, obviously because of Mumbai, and followed by Gujarat, which is 9,727, where we have our roots. Delhi is at hardly 350 Parsis. Given all this, how are you so center stage and so immersed in the Parsi experience?
Well, this is basically from my childhood. My family home is in Ahmedabad, the Vakil family at Navroji Hall, which is still home for me. And I think we grew up in a very large joint family. It wasn't as if we were told that we were Parsi and we had to follow something, but in the evening the loban would be taken around. And we would be playing on the swing, playing badminton, something. And on the veranda, the aunts and the uncles and the grandparents would start singing Monajats.
Oh, okay.
And especially, of course, Khudavand the Khavand. So we would hear the music and we would come and we would join them. So I think it was more an osmotic process of understanding what the community was all about and what the meaning of things was all about. If we were running around, you know, usually with chappals, going kizak kazak on the floor, somebody would say, Dikra, jara pug uthavine chalo. I to apru spenta armaiti che. When we crossed the from Ahmedabad to Bombay, which was a regular Gujarat mail journey, granny would always do our tili and then give us a flower in each one of our hands. so that as we cross the river, we will put the offering to Ava Yazid. So I think in that way, we absorbed a lot unconsciously. And also, we had a very remarkable lady who brought us up in many ways, because my parents and grandparents were very westernized. And that was Gulab Bilimoria. And she was our governess. I learned from her stitches of embroidery. I saw her doing embroidery. I saw her doing special chalk patterns for our birthdays. And I would hear stories from her. So I think all that interest grew, and it was inside me. On the other hand, we had a very different perspective, because Dad was in the army, General Setna. So we were sometimes 1,000 kilometers away from the nearest Agyari or Parsi settlement. At one level, we are both insiders and outsiders. So we could see the problems that the community was facing from the outside, and yet have that inner feeling. The other thing, how I was brought up, is that Sir Navroji had 5 daughters. And Zarathustra's last gatha is devoted to his daughter. And Sir Navroji's 5 daughters were extremely strong, independent women who did a lot for the community. And I think our parents and grandparents have brought us up to also be strong women who have done things for the community. You talk about me, but Niloufar Shroff, Dr. Niloufar Shroff, has been working for the Delhi Parsi Anjuman and for the community at large for many years. She's my right hand with the Geo Parsi program. Rukshana has run the Faroa classes for over 35 years for the Parsi children of Delhi and, of course, the rest of the country. And she's written a book, which is very popular.
My children also enjoyed that
program. Your children also came to the Faroa classes. And Shirin, my youngest sister, who's in Hyderabad, has worked not only for the Hyderabad, Secunderabad community, but for the Bombay community and everything pro bono. So I think all of us have inherited this sort of feeling for the community from our Ahmedabad roots.
Great.
So, and that is how we've been brought up, and we will work on it till we die, just as our parents did.
Okay, good. So the beauty of Gujarat has still remained. Many of us would remember the Romantic era poet, English poet, William Blake, for his "Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forests of the night. What immortal hand or eye there framed I fearful symmetry." Right? Besides being a poet, he was also a painter and a printmaker. But there's also an interesting connection between William Blake and our ancient religion, Zoroastrianism. Dr. Kama, you have been credited for discovering this connection during the course of your PhD researches while you're working at a British Museum and the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, under the guidance of none other than late Dr. Mary Boyce and Dr. Kathleen Rain. You consider this as a special academic achievement, so rightly. And in 2003, you also co-authored a book, Blake, Wordsworth and Coleridge. Tell us more about it, and how has this influenced your research and your teaching experience?
Now, Rose, I think this is also part of osmosis, because I was doing a I've always been interested in mysticism and spirituality. And I was doing an MPhil course on the Romantic poets, and I decided to work on William Blake. Dr. Kathleen Rain had come to Delhi to deliver a lecture at the IIC. And I was a student. I was sitting and taking notes, as we always do. And something kept on going on and on in my head that this is very familiar. I know this.
Okay.
Without ever having studied Blake in detail. She's talking about the prophetic books. And I made a note, and I still have that, saying, sounds very like Zoroastrianism. Mm-hmm. After the lecture, I went to talk to Dr. Rain, and I asked her, I said, was Blake influenced, or did he know about Zoroastrianism? Because he knew about a lot of Eastern sects. She said, I've never heard the word before. So I said, okay. But she said, look, he knew about so many things. Why don't you look into it? I began looking, and I found a picture which in Bryant, one of the antiquarian writers, which said probably by William Blake, and it showed a fravashi. That set me off on a 10-year tour
solid
of
proof.
Everything. Yeah. It wasn't proof as yet. It was
Perhaps
by William Blake.
Yeah.
So that set me off on a tour where I studied Jakob Burme, I studied Swedenborg, I studied the mystics, I got books translated from Latin, and finally I went to the British Museum because that has the original prints and drawings. Which is where I finally not only discovered the sign plates of Persepolis and Nakirishtam by William Blake, but the entire Bundahishan story from Anquetil de Perron, the creation story from Anquetil de Perron, accompanied these plates. And what I had been recognizing was that in the prophetic books, the doubt, despair, illumination, and unity, which you see in the prophetic books of William Blake, is the story of the Gathas in so many ways.
Okay.
The whole idea of how Zarathustra asks God, what is this, what is that, and then finally comes to enlightenment.
Okay.
And then from that onwards, of course, there were so many connections, and I found in his poems, I found drawings based on the bulls of Persepolis, etc. I promised both Kathleen Rain and Mary Boyce that I would publish in their lifetimes. Sadly, both of them died. I'm just saying, after I retire, AIR, I will publish my book. But of course, I've been writing about it. It's been all over the place articles and journals.
Okay.
But that was how I found the connection. What was very interesting and how it influenced my work was that I began looking very seriously at the 18th century. And I found some amazing things during my research, including a statement in one of the travelers that the legends of Zarathustra are so well known that I need not say more about them. Basically, teaching has been my joy. It's kept me young, because every year you're only with young people, which is sometimes why you also say things which you should not be saying. But LSR for me is what I call the OSS called LSR. In Delhi, which is so polluted and so this and so that, I'm so fortunate to be in charge of so many acres of garden over there. I'm on the garden committee.
Mm-hmm.
And I love LSR. It was my old college. And basically my students from my first batch, which is now 1983 was my first batch of students. I have actually taught my first batch's daughters.
Okay.
So it's been an amazing place.
Now from 2006 to 2009, you were the representative of government in India for the Nowruz candidature file for UNESCO Award of Intangible Culture Heritage of Humanity. And Nowruz was declared a International Festival of Spring by UNESCO in 2009. Tell us, how did this pan out?
It was a long, long process because, first of all, everything in UNESCO is in French and then it's translated into English, so it's not very easy. It was actually a Central Asian country which wanted to get Nowruz declared as a spring festival. This started in 2003. We found that whatever we had written about the Zoroastrian connection had been sidelined when we was sent the whole file for reappraisal, for relooking. So I protested to UNESCO. And after that, we worked again from 2008 on the Intangible Cultural Heritage of Humanity Award. And that award came to us in 2009. But what is more interesting is that we were six countries in the beginning. Today, there are more than 30 countries celebrating Nowruz, including Turkey.
Wow,
and even a greater honor was that the 71st UN General Assembly declared Nowruz to be the festival of spring.
Yes,
so for 10 years, you have an Intangible Cultural Heritage of Humanity Award, 10 years.
Right.
So from 2009 till 2019, every year, we worked on another aspect, a film, maybe ritual, maybe something in a Central Asian country, maybe something in Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, whatever. And finally, Mata Virani of Barzor represented the whole community of Nowroz at the spring, Almond Spring Festival in Sicily. And that was the final great proclamation coming to an end. So all of that has been preserved in the archives. And today I'm very happy to know that so many countries have declared it as a holiday. And of course, you know, in Iran, it's celebrated for 10 days. And even here at the Delhi Anjuman, we have the Nowroz table finally.
Yes, yes. You are a member of the Art and Humanities Research Council of UK and member of the International Advisory Group of European Research Council Project Multimedia YESNA under SOS University of London. And through that, you worked on the Everlasting Flame International Program, which was first exhibited in London. In March 2016, the Ministry of Affairs hosted the Everlasting International Flame Program in Delhi under the scheme of Hamari Darohar in collaboration with the Ministry of Culture and the Parzor Foundation.
That's right.
This was a mega event with three huge exhibitions. The first one was The Everlasting Flame, Zoroastrianism in History and Imagination. The second was Threads of Continuity, Zoroastrianism, Life and Culture. And the third was Painted Encounters, Parsi Traders and the Community. This the Everlasting Program was announced in the budget headlines of India. What led to this spectacular event, right? And how did you manage? Because this was an absolute unprecedented state. First time three such exhibits being put out anywhere in the world. So please.
It was a lot of very hard work. And that's the first time I took leave in more than 30 years of teaching. I took a year's duty leave for doing this. I couldn't teach and do this at the same time. I was all over the world. So basically, I was a curator for the Everlasting Flame program in England because SOAS and I have always been in close contact. Professor Almut Hinze, Sarah Stewart, all of them have been friends from the days of Mary Boyce. So I was a curator for that. And when I saw the impact in London, I really felt that this is something that should be seen in India because we are being forgotten. And the Ministry of Minority Affairs bought the idea, but it was very expensive. So it wasn't possible for the Ministry of Minority Affairs alone to support us. So it went right up to the PMO and finally the DG from the National Museum traveled with me to London and we signed the MOU at SOAS. And we had exhibitions coming in from very many different countries. And as I said, the Everlasting Flame, London could not have a single exhibit from Iran, which was a huge lacuna.
Sad, yes.
Because Iran and they have this big problem going on. And Iran went out of its way to send that huge, you've seen it, that huge Daraya statue and everything to us. And I think that was a very big benefit which we had in India. Plus we had things coming from Russia, we had things coming from all over the world, the exhibitions.
Sorry to interrupt you, but that means the Indian exhibition was much better than the one in London.
Oh, 100%.
Wow.
Sorry, I have to say that. There were three exhibitions here.
Yeah, yeah, also,
and
yes.
And remember that the Brunei Gallery is about one third the size of one of our exhibition galleries. And this was in three mega museums of India. And besides that, we decided to have the largest ever showcasing of the Zarathustris, which is why we had a 3 month long Everlasting Flame International program. It started on Nowroz. It started on Nowroz with the first time proper Patranu feast at the IGNCA lawns. And of course, we had Ratan Tata and everybody there in Parliament House when we launched the whole program, Karan Bilimoria and everybody. And besides that, what we did manage to do was we had film screenings, we had the Basha Ensemble of musicians from Iran, we had puppeteers from Azerbaijan. We had a massive amount of help from everywhere.
Okay.
It was only possible because of the generosity of the government of India. It was an 18 crore budget and we went well over that. And so it was a huge thing. It was not easy to get, but I persist. That is the whole
Congratulations.
Point.
Congratulations are in order over here also. Right. Now, under the Parzor umbrella, you as a founder and co-chair started the Return to Roots program, which has been so popular now. And you also part-funded the microfilming of the very important manuscripts of Zoroastrian faith, which are lying in the Mirzirana Library at Navsari, which was established in 1872. So, and there are so many other things under the Parzor umbrella that you've done. So just tell us more, and what are the other highlights that you particularly feel proud about in Parzor?
See, the point is that all of us who know about the community knew the problems we were facing. But it was only when UNESCO called me across, Richard Engelhardt of Bangkok called me across and said, he talked a little bit and then very bluntly asked me, he said, why is your community hell-bent on committing suicide?
Yes.
So I said, it's not such an easy thing. He said, okay, and we left it at that. Little while later, Mr. C.L. Sharma gives me a call and says, Frederico Mayor of the DG UNESCO Paris has granted extra budgetary funding of the huge amount of $4,500 for you to create a report as to what is happening to your community.
Okay.
Now, I'd been working with minority cultures. Culture is one of my topics of teaching and research. So we decided to go very bravely off to South Gujarat. By the time we reached Surat, we had run out of money. I mean, we didn't realize how expensive filming was. And though there was great hospitality from the Parsis of Gujarat, we really found so much wealth of material. But basically what I decided by the time I came back was whether it is yes with UNESCO or no with UNESCO, I'm not going to let this be. I'm going to record whatever I can. Because, you know, we've always looked at the Parsis of the villages as Bichara Parsi.
Gamdana Parsi.
Bichara Parsi. Eloko. You know, all those sort of things.
Yes.
What I found very ironic was that the monetary wealth of Bombay and the big cities has made us lose the wealth of culture and knowledge which is in our villages.
Oh, okay.
Be it the Hardwai tradition or the Hakim tradition or the Ved tradition of healing,
mm-hmm.
be it our songs, be it our Rit Rivaj, all of that. So that meant that I was going to go with it. See, India is a signatory to the UNESCO Convention. So it is, UNESCO is a catalyst. It's not a funding agency.
Right.
It was a great thing that they catalyzed the whole Parsi Zoroastrian project.
Right.
It came under Memory of the World program. Its number was 302 IND 4070. That was the UNESCO number we had. And basically with that, the government of India was supposed to help. We went with a begging bowl everywhere, Dad and I, to get funding. And nobody could understand why we wanted to record. If we're going to die, we're going to die. You know, that sort of attitude. We said, okay, fine. But we got great support at that time from Jimmy Gazdar and the BPP.
Mm-hmm.
And we also got great support from the Sardar Babji Tata Trust. We got small support from textile ministry from here, there, everywhere. And as I said, we've always worked for free in a voluntary capacity. We have always paid our researchers well. We've always kept the best tools because now 20 years later, we can pick up a photo, we can pick up a soundtrack and we can use it. So we created our website. We started getting wonderful responses from all over the world. And the first major project was the Mirzirana Library project. When we reached Navsari, we were told, yes, the Mirzirana Library is important, but it's only for priests. So the 16th Mirzirana, who came up riding at the back of a cycle, which scandalized the martyrs because They have seen how the Bias Ashram guards its high priest. And this little man was amazing. He opened this one Godrej safe where all the priestly important manuscripts were kept and showed it to us. We took photos, we talked about it, and we saw that some of them were in bad condition. Then I was just walking around and I saw something up on the wall, and I very dusty. I was wearing a kurta with a dupatta. And I asked Dastoji Sahib, Dastoji Sahib, I such hai. Are I to Badshah hai aap pe lo, Akbar Badshah hai aap pe lo.
Yeah, the minister.
So I said, Akbar Badshah hai aap pe lo. Then I clambered onto a table and with my dupatta I began cleaning it, and Dad immediately looked at it and saw the imperial seal.
Seal is there, yes.
So then we, Dushyant and Hemant brought it down, we began looking at it and we realized it was the firman from the court of Akbar, signed by Abul Fazl. And then Dastoji tells us, I bada chopdao upar che, S catalog ma. So we went upstairs. It was tragic because you could hardly open the books. They were stuck together. And what was there? Abul Fazl's letters. Letters from Jahangir to the Mirji Rana family. Emperor Jahangir to the emperor, to the Mirji Rana family. We found Tansen's khayal on Mayyar Mirji Rana at the court of Akbar at the Din-e-Ilahi. The amount of, and we found huge amount of material from the Persians exchanging with the priests of the court, exchanging with the priests of Navsari. So what we had to do was first just microfilm whatever we could before we started the preservation, because it was literally crumbling in front of our eyes. So we came back to Delhi and I spoke to my co-committee, and Pilu Jangalwala, whose hall we are sitting in right now, very kindly gave us a donation based on which the National Archives gave us 4 times the amount, and we started the digitization. It was microfilming
that time.
There was no digitization. Yeah. We started the microfilming project. Then we realized that once you microfilm and then you start restoring the books which are this small become that fat because they've been preserved. So then the SDTT Trust and the Vadias helped with Dad's help. They gave us funding for a new building, which was inaugurated and where my father's portrait hangs now. And after that, it was all digitized. And then in 2013, we had the honor of having Amitabh Ghosh himself deliver the keynote address at the first Mirji Rana, Dastoor Mirji Rana conference. And we had everybody from all over the world, the who's who of the Zoroastrian scholarship, in Navsari for I think it was three, four days, and walking tours and food and this and that, and everybody said we'd rather come to Navsari than go to Bombay. Now the Bombay people are not going to like them saying this, but it was the fact that they were actually exposed to the generosity of the Parsis of Gujarat,
right,
and they were absolutely mind blown by the treasures over there. You have a yoga manuscript written by a Parsi priest, you have the most amazing Shahnames, which one of them has been restored in Copenhagen, thanks to the ZTFE. They put the funding together. Then we had T35, which is a very rare manuscript. It opens up this big with the full drawings of the Dakma and many Ritrivaj and rituals. That was finally restored by Anupam Sah at the Prince of Wales, that's the CSMVS, just very recently, just before the lockdown. So we've been working there for 20 years. Okay. But I would love it if the Parsis would go to their heritage towns. There's Dadabhai Navroji's house there.
Yes.
There's the most amazing things to see.
The Mirji Rana Library, from my personal experience, my kids also participated in the Farwar program which you're running. I also accompanied them during the trip. Otherwise, I might never have gone to the library. And I think it's amazing to go and see, especially the Akbar's, all that over there. And we often, I mean, I was born in Bombay. We sometimes say, ke kaun Surat or Baroda, you know, gaon jaya karein, you know, but I think it's worth it. So if any of you all can, if you all are going that side, please make it a point to go and visit the library. can spend at least half an hour there just to get a feel of what's there, because a lot of the documents won't be accessible to public because they have to be protected because of the age and the condition that they're in. But it's worth a visit. I mean, a lot of our heritage lies there. Yes.
And that links up with the other thing, which is the RTR. The Return to Roots. I realize that whenever I send a researcher, and I always send them to Gujarat. If you are serious about doing a PhD on the Parsis, if you have not understood Gujarat, you don't understand the Parsis. Yes. Whenever I sent them off, they would be hooked for life. So I said, I know that the Israelis have been doing this. They send their children from America and all over the world to Israel, and they become very much a part of the community. So we decided to start a Return to Roots program. Fezana funded it, Hong Kong funded it in parts. Whoever could afford to fund it themselves funded it. And we ran it for 6 years. The last was just before the lockdown, when we had to fly out people as countries were closing down. Arzan Wadia has been magnificent. He has come every year. And we work together, and we've also had some very happy marriages out of it, so we're happy. So young people going into Gujarat, understanding Iranians and Iranians Atustis and Parsi Atustis. So it's been very interesting. So those are two projects, and besides that, there have been so many other things. I mean, where do you start and where do you end? But I think it was also very important that we've been doing, we did the Sam Manekshaw film and we released it fine. And that was another big story, because my dad has worked with Sam, and I've known him all my life in Sillu. And we always were told, never call us auntie and uncle, you call us Sam and Sillu. So, okay, fine. And after Sillu passed away, I saw that Sam was getting, we used to spend every winter, every summer in the Nilgiris. So we found that Sam was getting very low. But he was telling our children stories, which we realized they never knew anything about. We lived through Bangladesh. They never knew anything about Bangladesh. They never knew anything about Indira Gandhi. So I very hesitatingly told Sam, will you record for us? He said, nonsense. We finally persuaded Jahan, his grandson, to have a conversation with Sam. And Jessica Gupta, this young, wonderful filmmaker from NID, she took it up as her senior project. And that film was made without a single retake, because Sam spoke and Sam stopped speaking.
Okay. Sam, what was your greatest achievement in the army?
From the rank of second lieutenant to field marshal, I have never punished a man. My adjutant general, when I was the chief, and my judge advocate general used to get, wild. Court martial proceedings would come to me. If they said not guilty, I'd sign. If they said guilty and punished, I'd take the file home. I'll look at it, I'll say, no, I think witness number three has lied, with the so-and-so thing. And they say, sir, how can we maintain discipline with you as the army chief, you're not punished. I say, you damn chaps, sit in Delhi with your wife and your children in lovely homes, and you forget what those chaps are going through.
Okay. Of course, Jessica did a lot of research, and we have a large number of hours on record. Of course, we only made it into a
DVD.
It's a DVD. And recently, they're making a movie on Sam, a Bollywood movie on Sam. And those researchers came and sat with me, and I just opened my computer, and they saw picture and picture, and they said, okay, can we take it? I said, sure, as long as you don't make a mess of it. Well, you're welcome. Right. I'm waiting to see what they've done with it. So these are all the things that we've been doing, but many other things also. Homai Viharewala was another discovery, right in this very place we are talking in. I was going to Baroda on a field trip, and Dhan Aunty Bagli told me, "Tu Baroda jaich? Haan. Homai ne Mali ne aao jai." I said, "Kaun Homai?" "Homai Viharewala." So phoned up Rumi Mistry, phoned up people in Baroda. I said, "I need to meet Homai." They said, "We don't know who she is." India's first woman
photographer,
had been forgotten completely.
My goodness.
We discovered her. Hemant and Dushyant became great pals, because Madan Mata and Homai were contemporaries. And finally, we brought out her dream, her book. And yes. Based on that book, she and Sabina, the author, were invited to Harvard. And first the American embassy wouldn't give her a visa.
Visa, right.
Because she was 90 years old. Then they gave her a 10-year visa. And she had a ball, but she still preferred England because she says America is all right, but England is England. Her first trip abroad was at 90. And I'm very glad that we managed to do that book. And again, we have a lot of happy memories and a lot of material on Homai Vyarewal. These are just things that, there's so many things.
Now, it's almost 1,200 years since our ancestors fled from Persia, what it was called Persia at the time, what we call Iran now, due to the rise of Islamism. You have been very successful in getting a connection again with the modern day Iran, and through Parzor, as well as in your personal capacity, working closely with His Excellency, the Iranian Ambassador, Mr. Chegeni. Please tell us something about that.
Actually, my relationship with Iran started from the website. Because as soon as Iranian students would look at something like the flower catalogue of the Bundahishan or any of the research which we were putting up on the website, they would contact me through the website. And they wanted to know more. They came and worked with me. Mojgan Janara of the textile department came and worked with us for a year. Other people came and worked with us. When we were working on textiles, the what I call roots and roots, R-O-O-T-S and R-O-U-T-E-S of what we call Parsi embroidery, I realized it was in Iran, and then China, and then India, and then Europe, and it's a multicultural heritage of humanity. The first relationship was through young people. The second became their teachers, and Professor Darayush Akbarzadeh of ICTO, which is the Iran Tourism and Cultural Organization. He became, he came to Delhi, he worked with Parzor for I think about a year through Kapila Vatsyayan, who was also an executive council member. And through that it began building. Khwaja Piri from the Iran Cultural Center went with my father to the Mejirana Library. Ambassador Chegeni has been very kind. And I must say that His Excellency, the President Rouhani, also met us and when he came to India. And he told us very clearly that we want good relations with India and Iran. And we've had a couple of seminars with Mashhad University, with other universities, basically under the Asia Project, which used to be run by Kapilaji. And then was the 60th anniversary of Indo-Iranian relations. And Parzor was a partner with the Iranian embassy. And we had the Shahnameh exhibition, we had the seminar, we had the musical evening. We had a priest coming from Iran to talk at the lecture. And then of course COVID hit us. But I got a call from Yazd. And this was just after the community had lost, I think, two or three of our district presidents, heads, Zoroastrians.
Yes, that came in the media,
And there was this plea that because of sanctions, we can't get medicines. Can you help? I must say that Lord Karan Bilimoria, who happens to be my cousin, and Dr. Yusuf Hamid, who he introduced me to, Dr. Cyrus Poonawalla, whom I know, they rose to the occasion magnificently, and so did the Iran embassy. We finally flew out three plane loads of help, including ventilators and all
plane loads.
And we would deliver it to the embassy. And this was thanks to contributions from across the Zoroastrian world, from America to Australia to Singapore to Seychelles. Everybody donated. It was a huge risk, but I think the lives we saved were important, and one of the greatest rewards was a little clip sent to me of a mother who was a doctor and who was dying of COVID. And the medicines had to come from Switzerland because nobody knew what to treat and what to do, and etc., etc. Finally, after I think almost over a month in the ICU, she walked out and met her daughter.
Fantastic.
And the children sent me this little clip, which is on my phone, in fact. I think that was made it all the risks worthwhile, and the Iranian embassy was wonderful. The Iranian customs were wonderful, because injections like Actemra and all that had to be cleared very quickly. So it was a huge amount of work, but that has brought us much closer.
Fantastic.
That has brought us.
You are the Zoroastrian member on the Executive Council of the Temple of Understanding, along with Dr. Karan Singh. How do these interfaith activities help our community?
So at interfaith meetings and conferences, the general public comes to understand what is Zoroastrianism. They come to understand how close the Gathic Avestan is to the Rig Veda. If you understand Sanskrit, you can understand Gathic Avestan. What Panditji told me once, when I was just watching a yagna in an office, he poured in the ghee, he poured in the milk, he put the patta, and after the yagna is over, I told him, I said, you know, I have recorded the yashna for the first time professionally, and most of the symbolism is practically the same. So he said, Benji, आटा तो एक ही होता है उसमें से
बिस्किट बनाओ रोटी बनाओ या पूरी बनाओ
केक बनाओ पूरी बनाओ आटा तो एक ही होता है सो व्हाइल यू आर प्राउड Zoroastrians मोर इम्पोर्टेंट इट इज दैट यू हैव टू बी ह्यूमन एंड दैट इज व्हाट द इंटरफेथ मूवमेंट इज ट्राइंग टू ब्रिंग अबाउट एंड द होल दिस पार्लियामेंट ऑफ वर्ल्ड रिलीजन्स राइट नाउ इन अक्टूबर व्हिच आई पार्टिसिपेटेड इन with Fizana, ZTFE, and all the Zoroastrian organizations. It was the thing we worked on and we presented at the Parliament of World Religions was Ava Yazar than compassion. The whole idea of non-pollution, things of that sort.
Yes.
And we presented that. And I think the whole point is that unless the world's leaders and thinking people come together and work together, what future will our children inherit? That is the worry. So I think that is why the interfaith movement is very important. And frankly, for me, some of my earliest publications were done by the Sai Baba Center, because there are two or three books of mine which were brought out on the five human values and things of that sort. And every year I used to go and give a workshop for teachers and a workshop for principals. And thanks to all that effort, finally Zoroastrianism has appeared in CBSE textbooks. And I think it's very important that the world comes to know about it, and more important also that the Zoroastrian children come to know about it. And there's a very sweet story, I'm diverting a little bit from the Everlasting Flame, because we were closing after 3 months and schools in Bombay had just closed. May, June. So a group of school children came with their principal, Parsi school children, and they saw us pulling out boxes to pack. And this little girl, she says, Auntie, what are you doing? I said, we are packing up. She says, no. Why? I said, because this is an exhibition. It's come from all over the world. It has to go back. And she began crying. And she said, no, you have to keep it. We have to come and see it. And that's one appeal to my community. We have such treasures in our homes. We have such treasures in empty homes now. Please let us work together to create a Zarathustra Museum in Bombay, because we have so much which the world needs to see, seriously.
Okay. Can you tell us something about the Parsar publications that you all have brought out and the films, and also about the fantastic Friday Forum, I call it. It's not F square, it's F cube. Which you initiated during the COVID lockdown?
Our publications, as I've mentioned already, the first one, of course, was Homai Vyarewala, then we had The Joyous Flame, then we had the Sam Manekshaw film. Then we've done a very interesting thing called Asha, the Law of Harmony, which was for UNESCO, for a multinational candidature for UNESCO, which is on the, which is the first professional recording of the complete Yashna ceremony at the Dadar Madrasa, and how it is linked with the Kasti. Ashdeen, who was, as I told you, my first researcher, Ashdeen was actually started off working on Kasti weaving at NID. And his book, Threads of Continuity, The Craft of Kasti Weaving, he did the technical part of the weaving, and I did the part from the Zoroastrian text.
Perspective, right.
And we put it together, and when you read that book, which I hope you all will read, it shows you how when you wear the sadra and the kasti, you're actually in a very small, quick form, reenacting the entire yashna, which is a prayer which you do to all creation every morning in the great Atas Bairams of India. Then we did a very, again from an NID researcher, we did a interactive CD called Apru Navsari. And this girl Archana did a very good job of that. We've had, we are still in the middle of the second volume of the collected works of Dr. Dastoor Firoz Kotwal.
Yes.
The first volume is out.
Yes.
So there are all these publications. Then my own work has been published in various international journals, including and books, including the work on water, which is a publication by Paul Gray Macmillan, and a very important publication called the Global Textile Encounters, where I have explained what we mean by Zarathustra embroidery. So the publications are many.
Right.
Hopefully there will be a major publication on the craft of Parsi embroidery.
Mm-hmm.
So that is my another plan for after I retire.
Right, right, right. ND, FFF,
Fantastic
Friday Forum.
Fantastic Friday Forum. Actually, the Friday Forum started because our counselors, just when the lockdown happened, our counselors kept getting phone calls. People were frantic, especially women who were in stages of pregnancy, and they didn't know, they couldn't go to their doctors, they couldn't get checkups. So we started talking to them, and then we realized that instead of everybody sitting and talking on a phone line, let's do it on Zoom.
Session,
and
yeah,
by
yeah,
that
yeah,
time
yeah.
already we were practicing Zoom with classes and with college and with everything. So we began, first it was counseling, calming people down, songs and entertainment. Then I realized that, look, this is going to be a long, long time. And normally I go out on field trips during the holidays. Now there were not going to be any holidays or any field trips. So I said, why not, instead of going out to the field trip, get the information online.
Nine.
So we began with the people we knew. We have been very fortunate. We had people like Shamak Davar, Baman Irani, all of them working with us in some capacity or the other, completely pro bono. So we had a show with Shamak, we had a show with Baman Irani, we had Farah Gadiali and the Western
in
Opera,
India.
We had Pinaz Masani and
so,
Ghazal singing. And we've had so many things, be it about medicine, or be it about the Ilme Khushnume, be it about theosophy. These are researchers, students who want to interact with the audience. And that is how the Friday Forum is an interactive forum.
Yes.
And we gather this for our researchers, and we put it up and share it freely on YouTube. So anybody anywhere in the world can access it and gain this knowledge.
Right. I know you have a substantial long list of 2B programs. But also, I presume this would finally, I mean, aren't you creating an archive?
We're storing it all in a big, on the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
We are storing it all in a very big server. And we are making it accessible. So we are sorting out, as we go, every Friday Forum becomes accessible immediately. But remember that what you see for 1 hour, actually has 5 hours of material
behind it.
That's just like any film.
Yes,
so the 5 hours of material is available to a researcher who signs an NDA and who gets permission from the person.
Right.
So it's creating an archive.
Another puzzle activity which has been the need of the day is a center-sponsored GeoParsi scheme, which is aimed to arrest the decline in the Parsi population. How did it happen? And how did it make headlines in the budget?
Yeah, the budget is a nice surprises. When the Ministry of Minority Affairs was formed in 2006, my father, who had been in the Minorities Commission, was not very well, and yet he came with me to the newly formed ministry, and Salman Khurshid was the minister. They asked different faiths to give a brief on what was the problems facing the community. So we gave a brief education, this, medical, mm-hmm. this, that and the other, and obviously demographics, because wherever we toured, the question was, y'all are recording us, y'all are recording this, y'all are photographing this, but loko kahan chali gaya ch? The whole Sohali belt where the Iran Shah rested is empty villages. I call it the deserted village syndrome. Saheb kahan chhe? Saheb to Mumbai ma chhe. Saheb kare avela, 10 varas pehle avela. So the whole thing was, even in a place like Bharuch, which had so many thousand people, yeah. which is one of the world's oldest cities, we were down to 35. At one stage, I think we're now around 50. So the question, where are the people, where are the people? There have been lots of write-ups and demographic studies on this, the most important being Community at the Crossroads, 1941 by Shapur Desai, Professor R.M.I.T. Desai's father. He was secretary of the Bombay Parsi Panchayat. And after that, he had predicted that these things are going to happen because we've become too Western too quickly and we've adopted a norm which doesn't suit us in the Indian context. So we said, look, we all know this, but is it really true that our birth rate is falling? Is it really true? Because when you talk to people in Bombay at one stage, they would turn around and say, but wherever I look around me in Kharighat Colony, they're only Parsi, so there's no problem. We're very fine. Then when you talk to them about deserted villages, they were very skeptical. So we said, okay, let's commission studies. And that's where SDDT and other people helped out. And we did studies on the elderly, on youth, the family, on cancer with the Cancer Research Institute, Tata Memorial, genetics, and on untreatable hypertension, which is a major killer in our community.
Is it?
So
hypertension?
Untreatable hypertension. This was Nadir Bharucha's study. So we did these studies. We had a very major conference, international conference, which included geneticists from America and everywhere coming in. And we realized that our TFR, total fertility ratio, which is a replacement ratio, has to be at least 2.1. So for a married couple of two people, you need 2.1 to survive. We were already down to 0.88.
Yeah.
How can you survive? We are an inverted demographic triangle, and the older get larger and larger, the younger replacement gets smaller. 2001 census, Dr. Bhatia worked very closely with us. My father was alive then. And we recorded Zoroastrian, not in the other category, but the Zoroastrian
separately,
category.
Separately.
And he announced that the day will soon come when we will need a Save the Parsi program like we had saved the tiger. He actually said that. So when we gave this to MoMA, they came back to us and said, well, the demographics is the most important. They again, as usual, had to go for funding to the Planning Commission, permission to the Planning Commission. We had to bring on ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, all of those people. And ICMR told us that when you reach such a bad stage, it is going to be advocacy, which will be 70% of your positive growth. That means encouraging people to have children. Yes. And only 30% will be IVF, ICSI, and all the medical techniques. So we put together a program and we asked for 1 crore and we went to the Planning Commission. And the Planning Commission, very, very senior person there, heard us out and then said, why don't you tell your Pope to announce that you should have more children? So I just lost it. I was fed up by then. So I turned around and said, it is very sad that the Planning Commission does not know that we are highly individualistic people and we don't have a Pope and we believe in whatever we believe
in. We don't have a central leader
as such. We don't have a leader. So as we came out, Mr. Keki Daruwala was there. There were two researchers from Harvard there with me and they said, that's finished. There will be nothing more for the Parsis ever again from the Planning Commission.
You did it.
I came out, I said, you all keep quiet. People need to hear the truth sometimes. We'd asked for 1 crore, we got 10 crores. So Jio Parsi started. It did not really take off until Sambal Sara stepped in. God bless him. And Lara and Raj at Madison. they created the most shocking ads you could have, and we went viral because every feminist was after our blood. Everybody was after us. And the famous one, which you all know, and I'm going to say it over here, be responsible, don't use a condom tonight. So those went viral all over the world, and Jio Parse became a household name. We came in the New Yorker, we came in the Guardian, we came on BBC, we came on Al Jazeera. Everybody, even a child knows today that Jio Parse means hope for the community. Now to tell you something very interesting is that we've just on the 1st of November got the third tranche of Jio Parse. It's very important to note that now it is the health of a community, not just about creating, having more babies. We've already added 344 or 345 babies, but that's besides the point, that's just by medical. But besides that, the health of the community, which means it's a overarching care for your community program. We now support each elderly person from this 1st November to the tune of 10,000 rupees per month per person. And every child who was only supported till the age of 8 and only 4,000 rupees were given, now it is 8,000 rupees per child till the age of 18. The medical has also gone up from 8 lakhs to 10 lakhs plus 2.5 lakhs if you need NICU, that is neonatal incubator services and all that. The new Jio Parse program has started. A big campaign will be launched in by the beginning of the new year so that the whole world comes to know and comes and takes part in this, and you get a confidence back in having children, in having a family, in getting married at the right age, and in wanting to be happy. It is very important to thank also one person who I call our fairy godmother, Dr. Anaita Pandol. She's been with the BPP fertility clinic, and then she joined us as our advisor, and she's really blessed with a lucky hand. And the most difficult people who have not had a baby in 20 years have had children with her. It's also important for people across India to realize that you can choose your doctor, you can choose your hospital. The reimbursement comes directly to you through the PFMS system of the government. And in Navsari, with the help of WZO, we are helping people who need even the initial payments and things. So it is a very, very important thing that we all have to work together, as we are doing in Gujarat and across India, to increase the not just the numbers but also the health of the community. So that I think is an important takeaway which I hope you all have got from this, what I've been explaining to you all. There is one very important section in the new Jio Parse program, and that is creating a universal database of the population of Zarathustris. Once we have this database, we can actually tailor specific programs for specific areas, people, and link up people if we need to link them up, link up people with the right doctors, the right counselors, the right care homes. So we are going to be creating an ad campaign, and we are going to be using social media for this. It will be a very simple short form for you all to fill up, even on your phones. And we are going to request all of you to look out for the ads Count Me In, because each one of us should want to be counted in if we want to grow our community, if we want to provide health to the community, and we want to make ourselves once again a flourishing community.
You said so many specific things, but is there anything else in particular which, like a message to the community at large, you would like to?
I'm going back to right in the beginning, because a lot of people have actually fought with me on television saying that how can you say you're a feminist and talk about Jio Parse and having more children. Feminism is a choice, and all of us have had the choice to live our lives the way we wanted to live them. And I think the very nice thing which we have seen in our children, in our sons, is that they all are excelling also. They are graduates from, and they are PhDs from Cambridge and Yale and Harvard and top eye doctors of Delhi today. But they have, along with a great sense of discipline and excellence, also what we say daughters are normally brought up to have, a sensitivity and compassion. So we always say that we decided to bring up our sons as if we had brought up our daughters.
Okay.
And I think that's a very important thing, takeaway,
okay, yes,
which all parents should understand, that all boys and girls, our community talks about gender equality. We have lived with gender equality, and we, I hope, have passed it on to the next generation. I think it's very, very important that a small community should be united, and we should stop seeking attention by washing things which are not necessary to be washed in public.
In public.
I think it's very important to realize that today we are a very tiny minority with large possessions and very few people to look after them. It is all the more reason for us to be discreet about what we are doing and to be scrupulously honest in what we are doing. We are known for our honesty, we are respected for our honesty.
Yes, very much.
I think it's very important to keep that position,
right,
of being honest to a fault. And we have to stop quarreling, because every quarrel is blown up on social media. It is very dangerous for the community. And I'm saying this with all sincerity, it is actually dangerous for our community. So that is one thing. And the other thing which I really want to tell the community is, please respect your priests and your teachers. I do not like to see the way the priests are disrespected. It is very heartbreaking that you spend lakhs of rupees on a lagan or a navjot and you give a padika of 1,000 rupees to your priest. I think that is a shame. And our priests need support. If they have support, they can have also the chance to join the Empowering Mobeds program, to be empowered and to teach the community. Our priests we call dastoors. Dastoors means the learned ones.
Mm-hmm.
We should respect learning. So I'm speaking as a teacher and as a Zarathustri when I say that these are the two things I really would like the community to follow.
Right. Okay. Right. So I'm sure many people would have been enlightened by this very interesting conversation, though it's probably the proverbial tip of the iceberg. I know there's a lot more you could have told us had time allowed. But anyway, so on behalf of Mazda Multimedia, we wish you good luck and thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you, and thank you Mazda Multimedia for giving me so much of your time, for coming all the way to Delhi, and I hope this message reaches the community. Thank you.
Once again, on behalf of Mazda Multimedia, this is Navruz Bairamfaram signing off. Please make sure to keep tuned in to the future programs. Thank you.